What is it? Could be anything. Or it could be nothing, huh? Yeah. More than likely, it's nothing. But he's on alert. It's right before Christmas. By the way, welcome back to the farm. I wasn't going to do a program, but something came up. Something always comes up in my life. And I had to capture this on video because it's not going to come again. Every day, I want to explain something really quick. The littles, the trio, Rascal and Tanner, I don't know where Tanner is. He's around here nibbling on leaves or something. And Tiki, the little princess. All three of us, or four of us, and Mike, five of us, we go for walks every day because it's autumn and the dogs don't get out as much because it's not summer and it's not warm. So every day we make a point. Twice a day, all of us come out because Mike and I need exercise as well. And we take a walk along the entire perimeter of our property, all the way around the lower Unctown area, the upper Unctown area. And I think that probably amounts to something like over a quarter of a mile walk. And we do that a couple times a day. It's just a little bit of exercise for Mike and I to get the blood flowing. And also for the little dogs to go sniffing around, peeing around, marking their territory, having a good time, until it gets really too cold for us to be outside. So right now it's still okay. It's still I think in the day it's in the upper 30s, and at night it gets down to about 19 degrees, really, really cold. But they're enjoying it. I know that there's going to come a time when there's snow and it's below zero and it's hard to even take them outside except to go pee. So we're getting in all the fun that we can. Well, now that I've set the stage, I want to bring in the actors. We were taking a walk the other day, just like we always do. We're walking around. Mike and I are talking and stuff. And just out of the corner of my eye here, this is the corner. This is the corner of my eye. I noticed something big and dark. And it was rushing at me. And it scared the living daylights out of me because we own nothing big and dark. So I immediately turned back and I jumped. And it was this gigantic black dog that came running. It was barreling right towards me. And I had no idea whether it was going to be friendly or vicious because I just caught it out of the corner of my eye. And I braced myself and Mike goes, holy crap. And right as we said that, she dove at me. Yes, this big thing just threw herself at me, and she was all licks. Yes, so luckily I didn't get my head taken off, and she had this little fuzzy creature with her. It was, I think, a two-month-old puppy. It was all fuzzy and paws and tails and wags, and it was biting on her butt as she ran. So we had these two things and they showed up and we looked around. There's nobody around. There's no trucks. There's no cars. There's no nothing. We live out in the middle of nowhere. So I had no idea where these things came from. Now, the large one, that's a female, by the way, and the small one was a male. The large one, the black one, oh, she's beautiful. Oh, she was just a picture-perfect dog. She had a pink collar on, and we call those hunting collars because the hunters will put colored collars on their dogs when they go hunting. They go bird hunting out here. This is a big bird hunting area. There's pheasants, there's quail, there's partridges, there's all kinds of little birds out here that people like to shoot and eat. Well, they take their dogs out, and what the dogs do is the dogs run out in front of them and flush out the birds, and then when the birds fly up, the hunters shoot them dead, and then they take them home and they cook them up. Well, apparently these dogs must have gotten lost, and that does happen quite a bit out here. I wondered, whoop, there goes Bunny. Everything is possible out here on the farm. Anyway, back to my little nature story. The dogs do get lost sometimes. And also there are people who dump their dogs out in the country. So we don't know exactly what's going on, what the story of these dogs are. In our... Uh-oh. Rascal's barking. You never know what's going on when Rascal barks. Anyway, dogs get dumped out here. And you've seen, in the time that I've been out here, we've had three cats, and four, if you count the mangy cat that came in here not too long ago. Four cats and four dogs, well, actually about six to eight dogs, show up here. And they were, some of them were just tossaways and stuff, and some were the neighbor dogs who just come wandering around. Well, these dogs, I had no idea what was going on with them. And I checked them out to make sure that everything was okay with them. They were fine. What we did was we left them outside because I didn't want to let them inside. I didn't know what was going on. Do they have rabies? Are they sick? Are they going to attack our dogs? And so I put food and water out for them. and they stayed the night outside. Well, I'll continue my story. She's here. Hey, big head. Hey, come on over here. Come on over here and say hi to everybody. Come on over here. You big-headed dog. Yes, you are. I call her Big Head because I don't know her name. She doesn't have a name as far as I know. So I've just been calling her Big Head because she's got a really big head. Is she a beauty or what? She is sleek. She is strong. She is healthy as an ox. And she's sitting right on my microphone. This is what she does. She throws herself in my lap. And I want to introduce you to her. Yep, she is the newest member to the farm. Now, she's probably going to walk away and go out with the other dogs. So I want to continue with my story because this is very important. I want her to relay some information to you. She showed up with the other dog, and I left her outside because she seemed to not want to come inside. She shied away from the door. She would not come near that door. And she stayed outside, and she just curled up. It was cold, and she curled up, and everything was fine, and the little dog that was with her curled up with her. So that led me to believe that they were outdoor dogs. I put food and water out for them. Later on that evening, I hear barking, going nuts outside. Well, first of all, you know, Rascal and his posse didn't like her. And Rascal went right up to her and let her know who the boss of the farm was. And she's very gentle. She just kind of backed away and turned her head, which is a show of respect. She turned her head and put it down, which was a show of respect to Rascal and his authority. She could have swallowed him like a jelly bean, but she didn't. Anyway, and Tanner, he loves her. He has this crush on her. He likes big women. And he had the biggest crush on her. He couldn't stop following her around and falling down around her. He just loves her. Tiki, she couldn't be bothered. You know, she'd just rather go inside and go to sleep. Anyway, we left her outside. We heard this barking. And I couldn't figure out what was going on. So I went running outside and I opened up my door, my front door. And right out, not more than 20 feet in front of our door, standing as proud as you please, was a full-grown male coyote. Yes, a male coyote. And male coyotes out here are big. These are the large economy size. This large coyote is standing right out there, and she, the big dog, Big Head, she's barking. She runs up to the corner of my house and barks and turns around with her tail down and runs. And then the little dog is screaming and running around the house. It does not want anything to do with this coyote. So she's scared to death of this coyote, and the other one's scared to death of this coyote. And the coyote's not scared of anybody. I open up the door, and get this, coyote didn't even move. It looked right at me, and then it looked right at her. So I went waving my arms like a fool, and I ran after this coyote. I had to run about 5 feet towards it before it would even run away. This wild critter was not afraid of me or the dog at all. It just left because it really didn't want to deal with me. Now, I couldn't have that. And I think what the thing is that she's a large female, and she's probably coming to the age where she's in season, and which means she's not spayed. And coyotes will sniff around for dogs that are in heat. And I couldn't have that. I cannot have wild animals around here, not that size, because coyotes kill small dogs, cats, and they will eat them. Yes, they will. They'll even eat foxes. And so we cannot have coyotes around here at all. So I had to scare it away, and we had to drag her into the house. And the little dog wouldn't have anything to do with us. It just kept running away, and it would stay at arm's reach. So we couldn't get too awful close to the little dog, and I kept an eye out the door. And what happened was we let the dogs out later on that evening to go to the bathroom. And somebody in a big vehicle, a pickup truck, drove by really slow. And I figured, oh, it's probably their owner. So I sat down on the porch and I waited because they drove by a little bit too fast for me to stop them. And the dogs went running out towards the truck. And I waited and I watched, and the truck slowed down and it stopped. And I thought, oh, they picked up the dog. So I went back inside. And a little bit later, I hear barking outside again. And all I see is the big black dog. And I thought, well, that's kind of weird. I look for the little dog, and the little dog's nowhere to be found. What happened was they picked up the small dog and they left the big dog. It's like pick and choose. That's not right. So I didn't know what to do. So I brought her back in, and she's not an indoor dog. I had to force her. I had to actually pick her up and drag her into the house. And she was a huffing and a puffing because she's an outdoor dog and she's inside where it's warm. So she wasn't very comfortable. But I didn't want to take a chance with her and the coyotes. I just can't do that. So she spent the night inside. We took her to, I called up the sheriff the next day because out here there are no shelters. This isn't like the big city where you just take them to the nearest dog pound or shelter and you turn them in or call the animal control or humane society. We don't have that out here. What people out here do is they call the sheriff. And that's what I did. I called the sheriff, gave my information, a description of the dog, and generally people who lose their animals, they call the sheriff to find out if anybody's found their baby. Nothing, no word. So the following day, after we called the sheriff, we loaded her into the car, and that was that was a chore. And we drove her to our vet and had her chip checked because, you know, sometimes they will put a chip inside a dog, an ownership chip, and all they have to do is scan to find out if somebody owns this dog. Well, there was no chip. So we thought, oh, crap. What are we going to do? Well, I didn't want to go door to door. I don't do that. If a stray animal comes out, and this is just my way of thinking, it may not be yours, but this was our way of thinking. If you lose a dog, like say if Rascal turned up missing, I would go door to door and ask, have you seen this little dog? And give them my number and say, if you see this dog, please call me. I will be right over at the drop of a hat to pick up my dog. That's what I believe the owner of a dog should do. And I mentioned this to some friends, and they were saying, Ray, you should put ads in newspapers and put up signs and go door to door and ask people if they lost a dog. Well, there's so many animals that show up here and there. I'm not going to be that crazy man who comes walking up to everybody's door every month saying, hey, is this your dog? And second of all, as much as this may sound a little bit harsh or uncaring, it's not my job. It's not my job to find you when you lose your animal. You lost your animal or your animal lost you. It's up to you to go door to door out here. And there's not a whole lot of doors. That's the thing. There's only about 6 farms out here within a couple mile radius of my house. So there could only be 6 people that would that you'd have to check at. Go to their house and say, hey, have you seen my dog? And if you do, here's my number. Call up. That shows that you care. And that's what I wanted to do this program for. I want to let people know, if you lose your animal, don't expect everybody to be a good Samaritan and come looking for you. You should go looking for your dog. If you lose your child, don't expect somebody to come to your house with your child. You go look for your kid. It's your responsibility. These animals cannot take care of themselves. They need you to take care of them. And that's what I expect people to come looking for me. I'm an open door. If you lost your animal, you come over here, and I'm more than happy to return your critter to you. And after I think it was 4 or 5 days, nobody showed up. Nobody comes looking for their animal, and I thought, well, that's kind of ridiculous. Here's what happened. Here's the upside to this, okay? I decided, well, the least I can do, and it's not the least I can do, I was feeding this dog high-quality dog food, and this dog eats a lot. It eats more in one day than all 3 of my dogs eat in 2 days. So I was really going through the dog food. And this is not an inexpensive dog food. This is premium dog food that I feed the dogs to keep them healthy because I care. I was feeding this dog all I can and keeping it warm in the house and taking care of it and making sure that it was safe until somebody would show up. And if nobody's going to show up, eventually this is going to have to be my dog because I took responsibility for it. That's just the responsibility I took. And I really didn't mind. I thought, well, I guess you could be an addition to our house. Why not? So I was fully prepared to do that. And if I did, the first thing I was going to do is take her in, make sure that she's healthy, have her checked out, get her shots, and have her spayed as a responsible dog caretaker. I don't call myself an owner. I'm a caretaker. And I was all willing to do that. But I was going to probably wait. I said I was going to wait 2 weeks. I was going to wait a month. Okay, a whole month. And if nobody comes by after a month, then they either don't care about the dog or they don't deserve to have their animal back as far as I'm concerned. That's just my way of thinking. So, but I decided to go a little bit extra. And so what I did was I went outside and she is wonderful. She has bonded with me just this last week. She's learned to go inside and outside on command. She's learned the word no. She's learned her name is Big Head because I didn't want to give her a permanent name yet. So I call her Big Head. And she comes when she's called. Hey, Big Head, come here, baby. Papa loves you. Yes, he does. Yeah. So I would give her a regular name if I kept her. Well, what I did, I took a picture of her with my camera, the one that I'm filming with now. It takes perfect pictures. And I made a sign. I made a sign for it, and I put it out at the edge of my property by the road. And I'm where two roads meet, they conjoin. So this is a pretty well-traveled area, and I figured if somebody's looking for their dog, there's the sign. I left word and notification with the vet, the local vet, and that's where everybody would check, and also the sheriff's department. So I've done whatever I think that I can do. And as fortune would have it, a little Christmas miracle happened here on the farm. My propane guy, you know, my house runs on propane. Well, the guy who delivers propane to us from the company, he was driving by. And he stopped and he knocked on my door. He said, Ray, I was driving along the road praying for a Christmas tree. Because, you know, he doesn't make a lot of money. And he was just driving alongside of the road, and sometimes you'll see these pine trees growing in the ditch. Well, that's not anybody's property. That's just public property. And what he does is he cuts down a little pine tree to take home, and he and his little daughter can have Christmas. Well, he was driving along the road. He said, I was driving along the road praying for a Christmas tree, and I saw your sign. And I just happen to know who the owner of this dog is. And I said, please have them call me. I'm more than happy to get them their dog back. So he called them, and the person texted me last night, and my phone don't text. So I got this text I couldn't reply to. And I called the guy back. I said, if this is your dog, please, please call me back. And he did. He called me right back. He said, I'm out of town, and I lost my dog, and I've been looking all over for it. And I said, I wish you would have came to my door. And he goes, and this is what he said. He said, I really should have gone to people's doors, but I just didn't, and I'm sorry. Hey, yeah, I love you more than anything. And I said, that's not a problem at all. He said, I said, you can come by and get your dog today. He said, I'm out of town right now. I don't know what to do. I told him, I said, don't worry. She can spend the night here, have a slumber party with our dogs, and she's watching TV right now. She'll be just fine. He goes, wow, thank you. Thank you so much. I'll be by tomorrow. It's a high school kid. Yeah, it's just a kid who has his hunting dog, and he was just so happy that I would be willing to keep the dog overnight for him, and he's going to drop by today, and he's going to pick up his little sweetheart, and I know she's going to be so happy to see her daddy again, and I'm just more than happy to do this for him. And so I just wanted to bring this to your attention, that things happen. And it's not a perfect world. Sometimes bad things happen to perfectly good people and perfectly good animals. And so she's actually eating a piece of pine tree, her little Christmas thing. I don't know what her thing is. Anyway, I just wanted to bring this to your attention, that do whatever little you can. If you see a stray animal, try to help them out. And I know that we can't all take in animals. We don't have that ability. But whatever you can possibly do, just a little bit to help them. It's cold out there. And these poor animals, they're lost. They're scared. They're hungry. They're tired. And it's a scary world out there if you're a pet and you don't have your caretaker with you. I couldn't imagine little R being out there without anybody to look out for him. And so I would hope that there would be somebody out there that would do do for him what I did for her. She's, by the way, I wanted to film this in the morning because he's supposed to come by around lunch. So this is the only time you're going to see Big Head. And she's going to be home and safe. And I got his number. So if he ever shows up again, I know who to call. And he can come pick up his animal. Anyway, that's all I wanted to do. And this is just a special Christmas program. And I'm still working on getting those seeds ready. So you'll see me again January 1st. I'll be here with a brand new program with the seed giveaway. Everything's all set. So until then, I hope you enjoyed this short program. And have a great Christmas, everybody. Have a good day. And take care of the ones you love. Ready to go inside? You're shaking, aren't you? Let's go, baby dog. You, me, and Big Head. This is how they play. Good dog. Yeah. She likes you.